Hi everyone, welcome to ELI, the place where you get your daily dose of inspiration for entrepreneurship. And today we have with us Ms. Dimple Parmar, co-founder of ZenOnco.io, world's first integrative oncology health tech platform to extend lives of cancer patients and improve their quality of life. Dimple is a graduate of IIM Calcutta and has worked for companies such as Reliance Industries and BNY Mellon before starting her venture in 2018. Hi, Dimple. Welcome to ELI.
Thank you. Thank you, Praranjan. It's an honor to have you discuss about entrepreneurship, about startup with you. Thank you so much.
Dimple, I would request you to start by introducing yourself to our audience, please.
Okay. Great. As all of you know, I am Dimple Parmar. I'm co-founder and CEO of Love Heals Cancer and ZenOnco.io. Love Heals Cancer in NGO, which we started almost 2.5-3 years back to support cancer patients. And ZenOnco.io is a health tech startup to improve quality of life and extend life for cancer patients. This we started almost a year ago. The vision of both ventures are to how can we really make an impact in the lives of those millions of cancer patients, and in whichever way we can help them, be it medically, non-medically, whatever helps in improving their quality of life. And life is all what matters. How can we really make that impact in their lives? So that's what we do with at Love Heals Cancer and ZenOnco.io. And I think that's my introduction. Yeah.
Okay. Dimple, these two ventures you have, how they are connected with each other and what different purposes they solve in our society?
Yeah. So first we started Love Heals Cancer. That was started in March 2018 after I lost my husband to cancer. And that was the beginning of Love Heals Cancer. When I'm in the cancer journey as a caregiver, I could realize what all things are missing or what all things are needed when somebody goes through that disease. So I was in US at that time and I met some amazing scientists and mentors who are working in this field from last 50 years, learned a lot from them, and that's how I felt the need of doing something like this, which is integrative oncology in India. So integrative oncology is a combination of medical and non-medical treatment, which is medical and complementary treatment together. So together we call it integrative treatment because in cancer, we all take the treatment of radiation, surgery, chemotherapy, but then patients have a lot of side effects and the outcome, nobody can 100% guarantee the outcome. For every person, the outcomes are very different. So how can we find a balance between the hundreds of different kind of treatment approaches together and see what works best for that particular patient? So when I learned that, I saw that in US, it's much more popular, much more advanced, but we don't have that in India. So I came back to India and started doing research, talked to many doctors, patients, and everybody said, this is the need of the hour, and we should do something like this here. So I started with Love Heals Cancer, which is an NGO, and started visiting hospitals, doing so many activities, workshops, retreats, and that's how we were doing with Love Heals Cancer. And then soon enough, we realized that cancer affects everyone. It doesn't see race, caste, economic strata, nothing. It can happen to anybody. So there were a lot of demand from people about providing more services, about providing, not just horizontal, but also vertically going deeper into services. So that's how, and to make it self-sustainable, we started, me and other co-founder Kishan, we both started ZenOnco.io together. So me and Kishan, we both are from IIM Calcutta, and he was totally into finance. He was working with JP Morgan as an investment banker and then GIC Private Equity. And that's where he was also doing volunteering for Love Heals Cancer. And then he realized what all we can do in this field to really make that impact in people's lives. Because as I told you, life is only what matters at the end. And when you really are at a moment when you are between life and death, nothing else would matter to you except how can I live this day better. So Kishan decided to leave his finance career and we both started ZenOnco.io. where we help patients connecting with the right oncologist or the hospital or medical treatment or be it lab diagnostics or connecting with the cancer warriors, because they get lots of inspiration when they talk to other cancer patients. We recently launched a community, which is India's first and only cancer community by the name Connect, to connect cancer patients, survivors, doctors, healers, everybody together at one platform. It's like Facebook for cancer patients on our platform. We also have, we also launched recently, not recently, I would say it's now 5 months back, but world's first integrative oncology tool, AI-based tool, Zyoper. The full form is Integrative Oncology Preliminary Assessment Report for Cancer Patients. That's completely free for patients to download. And based on their inputs of their cancer and their physical condition, they can have their own analysis of their own reports, like what is my condition, what is going to happen next, not just medically, but also non-medically. So we always believe in the 360-degree approach for a cancer patient, because what I have seen in my journey, people who took 360-degree approach, who took holistic approach towards this disease, they could extend their life. They lived better even at last stage, and many of them also survived this disease. So it's all about finding balance between medical and complementary therapies together. And this is what we do, integrative oncology. So vision is same for Levels Cancer and Zenonco.io. Their sister concern vision is almost is exactly same for both, to improve quality of life and extend life. Just that the ways of to do is very different. With Levels Cancer, we do more of charity activities as well. We support below poverty line patients. We support them with groceries, nutrition, free emotional counseling, or we also celebrate festivals like Diwali or anything what comes, you know, like that. So we do that with them, because so we are located in the head office in Mumbai, and what we see, we have Tata Memorial here, and then thousands of patients come every year. They stay together in some dharamshalas, lodging facilities, and they have their entire family stay there. They have no other support and no family income, nothing. So for them, all these counseling sessions, these retreats, these healing circles helps a lot. So many activities we are trying to do with both ventures.
Okay. Dimple, it's a very interesting journey you have shared with us. My first question, it is, you know, I lost someone close to me to cancer last year, and that is how I started seeing cancer closely. And to be honest, I think our society is not much educated about cancer. If somebody hears about cancer, they just want to stay away from it. They just don't want to hear it altogether. So that is the state we are at. Can you tell us, whoever is watching this video, and to me also, what is cancer? You have seen so many cancer patients, their families and doctors and everyone in the ecosystem. Can you tell us, define what is cancer? Not from a biological point of view, but from a psychological and perspective.
Thank you for the clarification. I was just thinking which definition or in which way should I describe it. So I will skip the biological part of it, but when I talk from emotional or mental or family or financial or spiritual perspective, cancer is something which gives you purpose of your life. Cancer is a reminder, a wake-up call for you to really see in which direction you are going, what is happening. And it's a wake-up call for you to see what is going wrong in your life and where you need to improve. So when I talk to cancer winners, survivors, and also patients, survivors, they all say one thing, that cancer coming to my life is a blessing to me. It's a blessing in disguise, because it taught me so many things. It was a reminder for me what is most important in life. When cancer struck, the most important thing was, am I happy? What kind of relations I have? It doesn't matter where I'm working, how much money I have, what I'm doing, or no negativity, no grudges. It was, when it came, my entire focus was on my health, on my healing, on good relations, on making happy relations, on how can I live this day better? How can I make the most of this day? Reconnecting to my family, friends, and reconnecting back to Mother Earth, and really seeing, am I following healthy lifestyle, or am I still eating junk and not following that. So I would say cancer came as a wake-up call for all the survivors I have talked to. And even when Nitesh, for that, I see cancer was a reminder for me, for him, for all of us that, yes, we need to now really see. So when it was third stage, we did not really focus on disease. We were still studying and our focus was on startup and many other things. But when fourth stage came and then when doctor gave us timeline of 6 months, that's where it was like, now we need to wake up, what is happening? And then that's how we actually learned, explored about so many different things, what we can do to save this one person from all the perspective, not just medical, but also, as I said, complementary, integrative, emotional, physical, spiritual, from all the angles we try to manage this disease. So when somebody, you see somebody in your family or in your relatives, anybody you know is having cancer, I would say try to support them. Just ask them, is there anything which you can do for them? And because they need all the help which you can give them. They might not tell it to you, but they do really need that, because it is still scary disease for many people who don't know about it in detail. For me also, it was scary once. Today, it's not that scary for me because I know what needs to be done. I know a direction that, okay, today if something like this happens, this is the direction I will go into. So cancer is nothing but a reminder for you to really analyze, really see what needs to be done in your life now.
Okay. Dimple, let's talk about one particular stakeholder in the system, the doctors. What do you think, you must have met multiple doctors, and what in the Indian ecosystem, what you have seen, are the doctors best equipped and doing the best thing they can to the cancer patient? When I'm saying this, I also understand cancer is a very expensive treatment process, and many a times patient go through a lot of fear that has been instilled in them by doctors or other healthcare workers. What is your point of view on that?
Okay, so yes, I have talked to many doctors, and I remember when I came back to India, I was talking to one doctor from Cancer Hospital in Ahmedabad. And I was giving a lecture there on healing practices and integrative approaches towards holistic healing. And that hospital's HOD doctor, oncologist, was there. And the doctor himself said that if tomorrow somebody gets diagnosed in my family, or if I get diagnosed with cancer, I will not give my life to one doctor's hands. I will see what all options do I have, what is the best to be done for me. So doctors do understand the importance of integrative oncology. They know that it is very important. Even there are many doctors who tell their patients that take care of the nutrition, take care of the yoga, your fitness, emotional wellness. But it's just that it's, if you see doctor-patient ratio in India, it's very bad. So it's just that they don't have time to talk to patients about this in detail. For patients today, even today, doctors are God. So if doctors say something, they will ask 100 more questions. And then you know the doctors don't have that much time to spend on one patient. So though doctors believe in it, though they want to do it, but just that because of limited time, they are not able to do it. They accept it and very much, you know, open to talk about integrative oncology or the entire cancer care, how it is happening. From the doctor's perspective, I would say they try their best to save a person. They have learned medical science. They know how treatment, chemo, radiation, surgery works. And every doctor's purpose is to help the patient. And they try their best to do it. Not every time the outcome is same. Many times patients do not survive. But for doctors, it is very difficult to see their patients dying. If you see in world, the suicide ratio is highest among doctors because they see death day in, day night. And it's really difficult for them to see their patients going away. So I remember one of the doctors I met some time back, and he's a friend as well. So he said one of my patients passed away, and then the doctor was crying. And it happens, they don't show their emotions in front of patient, but it happens all the time. So many times I see also that, you know, patients, when things don't fall in place, they blame doctors. But then I also want to tell those people that the same doctor you trusted, the same doctor was there with you throughout this last 1 year. And when today things did not go as per you expected, doctor is not to be blamed, because you also should take control of your own health. You should also know, okay, doctor is doing their best, what they're equipped to do, which is the medical part. But you also should see what else can you do to help your patient, which is the complementary part as well. You should see, okay, what kind of nutrition, anti-cancer diet or yoga or pranayama or supplements, nutraceuticals, energy therapies, and so many other treatments which exist is what we do now. So, yes, doctors are doing their best, and treatment is expensive, no doubt about it. It is the entire health ecosystem we are talking, not just cancer. If you see any other surgery or treatment, it's super expensive. And that is why we have different strata of hospitals. There are economy class hospitals, there are luxury hospitals, which really depend upon you where you are going for the treatment. But yes, agreed, pharmaceutical drugs are very expensive, and to support patients, in fact, we recently started a program where we started giving discount on chemotherapy drugs up to 50%. One chemotherapy drug for fourth stage patient, it can go up to 1.5 lakhs, 2 lakhs, one time dose, I'm saying, and monthly it costs 3 to 4 lakhs. So if you get some relief on that, that's really good. So there's something needs to be changed in ecosystem for sure. It's not just doctors, it's also the hospital, it's also the insurance companies, it's also your pharmaceutical companies and distributors and everybody. So it's that's a different approach altogether. But yes, in it's then Xenoncodine levels cancer, in whatever way we are able to help patients, like financial assistance on that front, we give them up to 50% discount on chemotherapy drugs. We have partnered with pharma companies and all to support patients, because we know what all they are going through, and financial is a big concern for a cancer patient, because money is never ending when it comes to a cancer treatment. So right treatment is very important. That is why second opinion and many other things are coming in now. And when it comes to doctor's knowledge, doctors are very much knowledgeable on their medical part. But when it comes to integrative knowledge, they are not the expert in integrative treatment, because they know their part, but then there are 100 other therapies, and not every doctor knows the science behind those 100 therapies. So the approach we take is integrative approach, and other all 100 complementary therapies, there are scientific evidence after each therapy that why I am saying you should take this. So not all 100 are applicable on all cancer patients. It really depends upon your current stage and type of cancer and many other things, like what therapies you should go for. So that is something doctor is not, medical doctor is not equipped in, until unless the doctor has done the integrative oncology course and that certification. But they are very much equipped to do what they are already doing.
Okay. Dimple, let's talk about the ecosystem that is evolving, integrative treatment, as well as the other methods of treating cancer. I hear Ayurveda is also progressing in many ways in treating cancer. So, Dimple, can you suggest to our audience, whoever is watching, what are the different fields or areas they can explore in this particular industry to create value and solve problems which are not being solved at current times?
Are you talking about the integrative ways of treating cancer, or I did not understand your question correctly.
Not limited to just integrative treatment. I'm just talking in general, in solving the pain points of a cancer patient, or be it the stakeholders, be it doctors also. What are the problems people are facing, and how, let's say, some entrepreneur who is watching this video, how can he contribute to this field? How can he come up with a better solution in which particular area?
Oh, there are many areas where one can work in cancer care, many areas. Financial concern is a big concern, we already talked about. And there are corporates who has these programs to support cancer patients, just that it's not out there. But if somebody can work on that part where they just compile everything, all the government support and policies to support cancer patients. There are hospitals who have trust programs and patient support programs. There are pharma companies who have patient support programs. Corporates do have that. So there is a big need to put all these support programs together, so that tomorrow if I need some information, I can go there and access it very easily. That okay, I need assistance on nivolumab, which is a cancer drug, so where will I get discount, or where will I get support from which company, like that one is that area where it's big time needed, because patients don't know where to start. Next is cancer patients when unfortunately when patients dies, every family has lots of medicines, expensive medicines again, and they just throw it away. And then we get requests from many caregivers that where can we donate, and it happens all the time. So if somebody can also work on that area, where how can you really, you know, it's a complete logistic thing I'm talking about, collecting it from one and then distributing to the other who are in need. So that is something which can be done. In cancer, people give very less focus on the caregivers. So they are the people who are under most stressful condition when their patient is, you know, having cancer. They all of a sudden, they are like supermen, superwomen who have to do like everything. So something on that trend, where if somebody can, you know, like start supporting caregivers or have some services, which there are some startup, I think, who are providing attendants or maybe caregivers. It's a big time need. Many times, so cancer patients need 24/7 support. Even if you have a family member living with you, but still even they are not able to do that much, because it requires like everything out of that caregiver to be able to provide that much of support. And on top of it, you have to do your other things as well, which is doctor appointments and reports and arranging funds or arranging good nutrition, etc., etc. So something on that front should also be done, like how do we really manage the journey of a patient and caregiver. When it comes to treating cancer from different perspective, emotional wellness is very much needed. All the survivors I've talked to, the one thing was very common, that we had great family support and friend support. Not everybody is that fortunate to have that much of support from family and friends. Many times people don't talk about it. So, and people, I've also seen that they don't like to pay also for these services. But we have great pool of volunteers. There are we, as in not just we, but also other people who really want to support cancer patients. So something around that can also be started, where there are some startups in mental wellness. But again, as I said, people don't want to pay for it, because they're anyway paying a lot for cancer treatment itself. So something where, you know, there are a group of people who want to help cancer patients, and there are others who want to give back to society. So how can we really bridge the gap to bring these two together? And that's what we are trying to do with our community connect. So, and there are many ex-caregivers whose patients either have passed away or they have survived. So even they want to give back. So yeah, that can also be done. When it comes to cancer care, medical treatment is there. Hospitals are there. We know that. But what about integrative approach? What about how do you decide whether you should take Ayurveda or homeopathy, or you should take this diet or that diet, or what supplement or what therapy? And that is where Zenoncure.io came in, where we have thousands of evidence research on all these 100 therapies, which are like, okay, when you talk about nutraceuticals, you have curcumin, lycopene, beta-glucan, and omega-3, omega-6, and many others. Now, one person can't take all this. So there is a research which patients should take what type of supplements. So very different type of anti-cancer diet with antioxidants, immunity boosting, and all of those things are there. There are different kind of traditional medicines, such as Chinese medicine, Tibetan medicine, Ayurveda is there. That now it really depends. When it comes to traditional medicine, you need to decide which one you want to go for, because in cancer, not even doctors can tell you that there's a 100% guarantee that you will be cancer free and it will never come back to you. Even medical system is not able to tell you that. Everybody expects and hope for the best, that it should, after the treatment, it should not come back, or we just hope that doesn't come back. In Nitesh's case, it came back in just 2 days. He had fourth stage with multiple tumors in the body. While we thought that at least for 2 years he is good, because doctors observe you first for 2 years and then for 3 years. So in cancer, there is no right and wrong answer. That is why everybody is so scared of this disease. Ki hame pata hi nahi karna kya hai. In India, what I have seen, things are very very scattered, very unstructured. There is no one institution where I can go and tell that, okay, my husband has cancer, now it's in you, he's in your hands, do whatever you want to do. That's the huge need I felt here in India, because when I was in US, I saw that there were integrative centers. Simply what I had to do was to go there, and then they just mapped out all the plan for him. And I just wanted to make sure that he's following it. But here, patients and caregivers do all the research. They talk to neighbors, they talk to communities, they talk to different people who will have hundreds of different opinions. But are these opinions based on the scientific facts and figures? Even if it is, in cancer, what worked on one person of colon cancer will not or might not work on the second person with colon cancer, because there are trillions of cells in our body and cancer works very differently with different people. Even treatment work very different with different people. Rarely people get recurrence within 2 days, but Nitish got the recurrence. Never expected that. And doctors don't have answer that why did he get fourth stage so soon. Like 2 days back, we stopped his treatment and in 2 days he had like multiple tumors. That is why it is a scary disease, because nobody knows the standard answer, what's going to really cure this, what's really going to give you guarantee that it won't come back. So we need to find a balance from these 100 therapies, which one we should go for, how it's going to benefit us. And that is what we are trying to do for cancer patients. And that's another huge need, I would say, for cancer patients, because when somebody has cancer in your family, as I told you, in front of life, nothing else matters. You will do each and everything possible in this world to save this person. And if somebody is giving you a ray of hope, that's all matters. So those who are listening to this video, be it cancer or any other chronic illness, cancer is a different chronic illness, because when you hear the word, you immediately think about life and death. Though the scenario has changed in today's time, but still, there are years before we reach there when we are fully confident about this disease. If you see in US, cancer diagnosis rate is very frequent than people in India. But in US, the survival chances or the quality of life expectancy is more than in India, because quality of life here is not good. So that is the vision of Xenon4.io, to improve quality of life, because once that improves, automatically your life will get extended. So yeah.
Okay. Dimple, we are almost up with time. If you have some more time, then we can I can ask some more interesting questions.
Okay, we can talk for 5-10 minutes more.
Okay, now a few questions about your journey as an entrepreneur. Let's leave the industry and problem we are trying to solve. As an entrepreneur, tell us what are the different challenges you have faced along the way to build this venture.
Oh, as an entrepreneur, I would say for me, me and Kishan, we form a great team together. We both are friends from last 5 years, and also we have done like many startup competition in colleges. Never thought that we will be doing actual startup together, and we are life partners as well, so get along with each other very well. So that way we have great support of each other in doing this. I would say initially we had challenge of forming a good team, which now we overcame, and we got a really good team together in place. With experiences, we understood or we learned that what kind of people who understand this passion, this vision, and really empathetic and feel for cancer patients, they tend to get along with us better. So yeah, it was a bit of challenge in the beginning, but then when we got a hang of it, when we understood what is really needed, it was like easy for us to do. As an entrepreneur, I would say we all are like very passionate to make it happen. So not many challenges, except that yes, there's always shortage of time. Time itna jaldi mahine nikal jaate lagta, oh my god, it's already months. But then yeah, what we have achieved in last I would say less than 1 year's time, when I look back, I feel good, I feel humbled, I feel proud of what we the entire team has done. So it's very interesting and exciting journey. As long as you are motivated, as long as you know in which direction you are going, as long as your vision and mission is very clear, as long as you have set a few not goals, but as a set of few rules, that okay, this is what I'm going to stick to no matter what. I'm talking in terms of your vision, not the processes, because processes changes as you learn, as you work. But as long as that is very clear, journey becomes very exciting, and all you need to do is just to do lots of hard work and take feedback from the team, take feedback from your patients, and that's what I like to do the most. I always, with team, very open. Guys, if you don't want to share feedback, here is the anonymous link. Please do share feedback. So that is, I think that is what helps us more, taking feedback from patients, from our team members, like where we can improve. And I feel that not just me and Kishan, but the entire team, the entire people, everybody like who are working for with us, they all are entrepreneurs. I always tell them that you are entrepreneur in your own department. So do whatever you want to do, because you are the person who is working on field to make it happen. I don't know everything about digital marketing or everything about patient care or everything about business development. You know about it better. So let's discuss it together and then open to feedback. So challenges wise, I would say the putting team together was initially a challenge, but once you know what you do here, it becomes very easy. Yeah.
Okay. Talking about two common challenges all founders face, one is recruitment, finding the right people to take the vision forward, then there is funding. Like to start with funding. How did you manage the funds to build and run this venture?
Yeah. So about funds, I would say Kishan, when he joined, when we both started Zenoco.io, we initially discussed like, is it the right time or should we do it later? But as you see, you know, like when you want to really want to do something, this is the right time for you to do it. So one day, Kishan, I was at the center and Kishan messaged me from his company, you know, that, okay, I'm thinking of quitting and joining you. I was like, what? He's like, yeah, because otherwise the right time will never come. And then he just resigned and we both started. So he had good savings from his 3 years of earnings. And so that money we got together. And then also we, because we both are very much passionate to do something and we know that, okay, we can, if you know, like with the hard work and the good team and everything, we can make it happen. So we also, so Kishan had a home. So we also sold that home to sustain it for some longer time. And then when it was the right time for us, we'll go for the funding. Yeah.
Okay. And talking about recruitment, when you said you have found some amazing people over time, what is the standard criteria you follow to either judge or, you know, find or filter out who would be the right person for your vision?
Very important question, I would say. Because the few criteria what now we have decided upon is the person should be compassionate and empathetic. Because it is not just patient care department, but also even if it's a tech person, even if it's, you know, like other department who is not client patient facing, has to be empathetic and compassionate, because that is why we are here together to work as a team. Because if you are not talking to your colleague in a proper manner or without, like, you know, having compassion or empathy, then there will not be a strong team together. So that's the one criteria we see. Second criteria we see is, you know, like how then we ask indirect questions to know about their bonding with their family members. So that's how we get to know that, okay, apni khud ki family ka liye kitna attached hai, kitna dhyan rakh rahe hai. So that's because if one first, that should be the thing that, you know, you are attached to your family, you want to take care of them, you are taking care of them, you are concerned for them. Because if that is not there, then we are just connecting with you. So I don't know how well you will take care of this company. So that is another criteria we see. And then we check the skills and do the matching. But skills you will see in many people. It's like India is full of talent, I would say. Mm. But having those criteria are more important for us. So hardworking is another thing we see, because it's a startup and it's a growing startup. So you need people who are passionate, that if it requires to launch something and if it requires to stay back, do extra work, you should be able to do that. So yeah, but otherwise here we have kept very open culture, open feedback. Whatever, give anonymous feedback if you don't want to talk openly. But yeah, we do appreciate, acknowledge everything. We give recognition as well. So that really keeps motivated people going. Yeah.
Okay. Dimple, almost done. Last question to you. How would you suggest our viewers or any young people to start their journey as entrepreneurs, be it healthcare or be it to any field?
Okay. So what I learned from my last two startups, first you really understand. So my first startup was Zapple, which was in Indian women customized footwear. It was back in college 5 years back. So in that startup, the mistake which I did was it was capital heavy startup. So lots of capital pumped in, and also first I should have on, like, you know, like dheere dheere start karna chahiye tha. Uski jagah pe I just went all in together. and then realized that, okay, a few of the things could have been outsourced very easily, like making of the shoe and all of those things. Rather, I actually started own manufacturing unit in Mumbai. So that was a mistake. So for those who are thinking of starting their own startup, I would say go first, you do a pilot. Whatever is your product or service, whatever services you can outsource to begin with, do that so that you are not putting all your money together at once. And then by the time your team and your you got a good idea what to do next, you are out of money. It shouldn't be like that. So outsourcing, yes. And then once your pilot is ready, always do pilot first. And then because again, the new what thing I learned in my this Lovell's cancer is that, you know, we made a very good website in the beginning, spent a lot of money on that. And it was a community website and a different kind of, like, I would say Facebook like that. But then soon enough, I realized that, no, I should have started it slowly, make a basic website first and then make that version of it. Ultimately, we had to scrap that and start a new website. So, yeah, go slow. Go slow, not in terms of your passion or your work, but go slow in terms of where you're putting your money in terms of, because now today, if you see everything like digital marketing or website or everything can be outsourced. Next would be whatever is your vision, you or mission, what is your target, you fix on that first and then build things around that. I have seen somewhere, you know, like people keep on changing their vision and mission as they work, and then after a few months you see that, okay, where are you currently, because 4 months back you started with something else and then today your vision and everything has changed and you don't even realize that. So have that vision fixed and then do things around that and you will see you will do wonderful in that. So that is very important. You should be like, you should not burn out while you're working. Even if you're working 18 hours or 16 hours, you should really enjoy doing that. That if you see that, okay, you're not enjoying, then you should really rethink, and not necessarily that, okay, the idea has come to you. So you should really, really work on that. Even if things are not going right, always have those few mentors, that one advisor, maybe senior advisor, of course, who also connect with you in terms of you, your frequency matches a lot. And then always ask their feedback in terms of wherever you're getting stuck. That is very important thing I would suggest, because people have great experience and you should leverage on that.
Okay. Dimple, I see that you are a born entrepreneur. Once an entrepreneur, always an entrepreneur. On that note, I would close this session, and it was a great pleasure and an honor to host you here at ELI. Our audience would have got great lessons. Thanks for your time, Dimple. And our best wishes to Jen on Co.
Thank you so much, Viranjan. Thank you. Take care. Bye-bye.
Viewers, you can follow and connect with Dimple on LinkedIn by searching for Dimple Palmer. Also, do visit their website on zenonco.io. That is it for today's episode. We'll be back with another exciting entrepreneur. Stay tuned to ELI.